Welcome and thank you for tuning in to the expression of the Father's love. Thank you. I trust that you are enjoying your new year. May the Lord richly bless you and your family. I trust today that you will have a wonderful and productive day in Jesus' name. Today, I just want us to look at the Word of God. But before we do that, let us pray. Father, we bless you for every viewer. We thank you for their lives, their family. We pray, oh God, that you will continue to touch them. You will continue to open hearts, God, that many would respond to you, oh God, in a positive way. We thank you for breaking chains. We thank you for setting the captives free. We thank you, oh God, for your love that has been made manifest to us all. We thank you, oh God, in Jesus' name. Amen. And amen. I'm happy that you are here today and you can tune in to the expression of the Father's love. Today I want to look at the book of Isaiah chapter 1, reading from verses 18 to 20. Isaiah chapter 1, reading from verses 18 to 20. And it says, "Come now," God speaking, "come now and let us reason together, saith the Lord. Though your sins be as scarlet, they shall be as white as snow. Though they be red as like crimson, they shall be as wool. If you be willing and obedient, ye shall eat the good of the land. But if you refuse and rebel, he shall be devoured with the sword. For the mouth of the Lord has spoken it." Father, your word is already blessed. Bless it to our hearts today in Jesus' name. Amen. I want to talk to us today on the subject, it is time to respond to the Master's call. It is time to respond to the Master's call. In this very book, the prophet Isaiah is given a vision that he received from Almighty God concerning Judah and Jerusalem. The situation was so bleak in terms of their spiritual condition that it was alarming. It was frightening. Hallelujah. God revealed to Isaiah the picture, the status of the real situation, the spiritual condition of the children of Israel then. He said, as he begins the chapter, he's talking about their condition and he's referring to them as one that has forgotten God. A people that has forgotten God. In fact, in verse number 2, he says to them, "Hear, O heavens, and give ear, earth. For I have nourished and brought up children, and they have rebelled against me." The fact that God begins the chapter through the prophet by highlighting that the children of Israel, whom he had delivered from the clutches and delivered them from Egyptian bondage, and had made them a nation and have given them laws and have helped them to become a mighty nation, possessing the land of Canaan, they have come to this point in their life where they have now become corrupted, where they have strayed from the principles of the word of God. They have been doing their own thing and think nothing is wrong with it. They have become so away from God, so entranced from God, so separated from God spiritually, that they weren't aware of their spiritual condition. In fact, the Bible tells us, hallelujah, as again in verse 12, Isaiah speaking to them says, "When he come to appear before me, who had required this at your hand, to tread my courts, bring no more vain oblations, incense and is abomination unto me, the new moons and sabbaths, the calling of assemblies, I cannot away with it, it is iniquity, even the solemn meeting, your new moons and your appointed feasts, my soul hateth, they are trouble unto me, I am weary to bear them. And you spread out forth your hands. I will hide my eyes from you. Yea, when you make many prayers, I will not hear. Your hands are full of blood." And then God is calling them.
Hallelujah, to wash themselves. Hallelujah. He's calling upon them to put away the evil of their doings from before his eyes, to cease from doing evil, to learn to do well, to seek judgment, to relieve the oppressed, to judge the fatherless, to plead for the widows. Their conditions, hallelujah, as you see the condition of Israel, hallelujah. The oppressed, they weren't relieving. The widows, they were not, hallelujah, speaking on their behalf. They need to be washed. In fact, they were filthy. So filthy, hallelujah. And the Isaiah pictures them as a corpse that is alive, rotten from the sole of their foot to their head. Hallelujah. Why should God chastise them more and more? Many times he would afflict them through the enemies, through famines, through many circumstances, hoping that Israel will come back to God rather than going after false God, rather than forsaking their God. And many people are like that today. They have strayed so far from God, and yet they think that by their morning prayers or their nighttime prayers, it will suffice God. Some people think by their good deeds, they will suffice God, because in their heart, they are doing a number of things that are good. They are going to church on Sunday. They are praying in the mornings. They are praying in the nighttime. But yet, hallelujah, they live a secret life. Yet, hallelujah, hallelujah, their hands are defiled with blood. Yet, they are corruptors. They live ungodly lives. Day by day, and forgetting that the God who knows all things knows their particular situation. The God who sees all things have seen their situation, have seen their lifestyle, have observed their lifestyle, and can no longer bear it. You see, sin, hallelujah, hallelujah, would separate us from Almighty God. And here in the very text, God wanting, hallelujah, to show the people of Israel and Judah that he is a merciful God. But if they would amend their ways, if they will turn to God, if they would forsake evil, he's ready to forgive them. He's ready to pardon them. And this is the same situation that faces us today in our nation. We have people who are doing all kinds of things that are contrary to the will of Almighty God. And they believe by their continually coming to church on Sunday or Saturday, as the case might be, they think by their morning prayers or their nighttime prayers, everything is okay with them. But I'm here to let you know today, hallelujah, God is calling upon each and every one of us to forsake our evil ways, to repent of our sins, and come to Almighty God to confess them so that he would give us mercy. And the situation that faces Judah and Jerusalem then is no different to us today, because many of us, hallelujah, are strayed so far from God, and we think by our good deeds we have earned the right to make it into the kingdom of God. But God is a merciful God, and this morning I'm here to encourage you. I'm here to encourage you. It's time to respond to the Master's call. It's time to respond to the Master's call for the following reason. One, time is short. The first reason why we must respond to the Master's call is because time is short. Many people hold on to the fallacy, hallelujah, that heaven and hell is right here. Many people hold on to the view that since we have heard that God has come in, since our mothers and our fathers were young and now they are old and God have not yet come. Many people believe that God have abandoned his coming. Many people believe God have delayed his coming. In fact, some people believe God will not come in my lifetime. But I'm here to let you know that the hour is late. His time is short. The call is an urgent one. God speaking says, come now. Hallelujah. There's no time for delay. There's no time for procrastinating, making the most important decision of your life, because the call is an urgent one. And if you hear God speaking to your heart, please, sir, madam, don't harden your heart. The time is short. So short, hallelujah, that some people, hallelujah, it's short because a number of people may not live to reach their 50th year. Some may not even live to reach their 30th year. But I'm letting you know today, time is short because the coming of Christ is closer than when we first believe. It can be any moment now. Prophetical fulfillments are all around us, and we need to focus on the most important thing in our life. That is our soul. What will be with our soul? What will be with our soul? I'm here to encourage you, because plenty of people believe that they have time because they are young. No, sir. Time is not yours, sir. It is the Master's. And He is the one calling every man everywhere to repent, because the time is short. The hour is late. His appearing can be any moment. And you don't want to be left behind to face the unwrath or the wrath of the devil. You don't want to be left behind. You don't want to, hallelujah, be lost forever. Time is short. It's important that you make the most important decision of your life now. Don't put it off, sir. You have put it off already. But God is calling men to look at your lifestyle. Evaluate how you've been living. And you will know it deep down in your heart that you need God. You will know deep down in your heart that you have not made a commitment to serve God. You go to church on Sunday, but yet you live all kinds of life. But it's time now, oh God, it's calling men to review your life and come honestly and come sincerely, because you're always late. You have heard the gospel already. How many times have you heard it? Have not yet responded to His call. Today He's calling you again. He's calling you again. Time is short. Time is not on your side. Hallelujah. The devil, he walks around like a roaring lion. He's looking for men and women he will devour. He's looking for children who you will devour. And the longer you wait, the longer you wait, you give Him greater chance of succeeding over your life. When you put off God, when you put off salvation, when you put off repenting of your sins, you're giving the devil more time, more space to pounce at you. But I'm here to let you know, whether you give your life to God or not, He will pounce. But you're always safer when you're in the arms of Jesus. You're always safer when you have repented of your sins. Because if you die in your sins, you will go to a Christless eternity. But if you die accepting Jesus as Lord and Savior, the Bible says to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. Time is short. The most important decision in your life is before your eyes. It's right before you. Don't waste time. Don't make excuses. Don't put it off. Time is short. And that's why the Master is calling you now. It's an urgent call. Come now. Some people have heard that call and refuse to obey. Some people have heard that call and make excuses. Some people have heard that call and wait and wait and wait until, hallelujah, catastrophe hits. Not everybody might have the opportunity of a second chance, or a third chance, or a 50th chance, or a 100th chance. I don't know how many chances you have in your life, but God spared you for a particular reason. And while you're here today, please, when your hair is called, don't put it off, because time is short. Hallelujah, the Master called. Why? Secondly, because He wants to reason with you. The Master is calling men and women because He wants to reason. The idea of reason is to have a discussion about your spiritual destiny, to have a discussion about your life, how you've been living. The situation with Judah and Jerusalem was like a filthy one. They were terrible. Hallelujah, their sins, hallelujah, from the sole of their foot to the crown of the head, they was full of sores that had not been bound up. Their condition was terrible. But yet, God wants to give them opportunity to forsake their evil way, to forsake their sins, to come before him, not to come to make excuse, not to come to seek to justify yourself, but come just as you are and say to God that I am a sinner and I have done many things that I'm not proud about, but I'm ready to repent. That is the call and that is the response that the master is looking for, because all of us who are born in sin and shaped in iniquity, all of us, hallelujah, our goodness is as filthy rags before him. So it makes no sense. Try to justify yourself before God in saying that you have done a number of good things. Yes, there are a number of good people who are in hell today because they failed to repent of their sins. Don't let that happen to you. Accept the master's response. Confess your sins before God, because the children of Judah, hallelujah, they were praying and God says, I will hide from you because you're not washing yourself, because you're not relieving the oppressed, because you're not learning to do good, because you're not willing to repent of your sins and turn from it. But yet you want to come before God with long prayers and long tears. Hallelujah. He's waiting for a confession of your sins. He's waiting for repentance of it. That you will turn from your wicked ways. And you will come to him and serve him all the days of your life. That you will mean it from the depths of your heart. You're not just making it because it is New Year's Day. But you mean it in the depths of your heart. That you are prepared to follow Jesus all the way. He wants to reason with all of us. He says, come, let us reason together, saith the Lord. He wants to have a discussion with you. He wants to have a discourse. Let's evaluate how you've been living. You be honest with yourself. Is that what God requires? You can pray to him at morning and do what you want during the day. Oh no. He wants you to live for him every moment of the day. He wants you to serve him. He wants you to make a commitment to entrust your life in his hand. He wants you to repent from your sins. He wants you to turn from your wicked ways. Many of us, we fail to do that because we're enjoying the pleasure of this world. But sir, the pleasure of this world is for a season. You may not always have the opportunity or the health to enjoy it. So I'm going to beckon on you today. I'm pleading with you today. If you hear God prompting at your heart, please don't make excuses. Please don't seek to justify yourself. All he wants is for you to reason and to be honest with him and confess your sins and turn from them. Because God knows there's nothing that you can hide from him. He has seen you every day. Your life is open before him. There's nothing you can hide from the Almighty God. Nothing. So it makes sense to come clean. It makes sense to be honest with him. It makes sense to open up and to say, God, I'm sorry. And mean it from the depth of your heart. This is what he's looking for. That's why he's calling you now. So that you can reason with him. I want to encourage you to reason with him. To confess your sins before him. No hiding. To say, I'm sorry. Just as Adam and Eve did. When God called them, they said, yeah, Lord. We heard and we hid. Yes, because of our sins. Because of what we have done. And when God asked the question, what have you done? They confess and said, we did eat. They confess, Adam first says, she gave it to me and I did eat. He confessed. And therefore God was able to cover them. Hallelujah. God was able to, hallelujah, slay an animal and cover their sins. Because the time will come when the Almighty will send his only begotten Son to die for their sins. And he will not just cover them temporarily, but when he comes, his blood will wash away your sins and make you as white as snow. Hallelujah. Not only is time short, not only he's calling because he wants to reason with you, he is calling, because he's the only one that can fix your sin problem. Hallelujah. Many people believe, hallelujah, they can fix their sin problems by running away. Some people believe, like Jonah, they can run far from God and their problem will be fixed. Oh no. Some people believe, hallelujah, hallelujah, that long tears will fix their problem. Some people believe if they do so much good, it will fix their problem. Oh no! The only person that can fix your problem is God Himself, Jesus Christ, sending His Son in the person of Jesus Christ. And His blood will wash away your sins. His blood and His blood alone has brought redemption. The Bible says, as Isaiah put it forth to us, that though your sins be as scarlet, though it be red so that it cannot be red anymore, regardless of your status, His blood is able to wash away all of your sins. Yes, sir. The blood that flows from Emmanuel's veins. Hallelujah. If sinners plunge beneath that blood, they will lose all their guilty stain. His blood has atoning power. His blood is able to cleanse you, sir. He's able to fix you. But on the condition that you confess your sins, that you're willing to turn from your wicked ways, He will forgive you of your sins and cleanse you from all unrighteousness. The book of John, 1 John 1 and 9 said, the writer says, if you would confess your sins, that God is faithful and just to forgive you of all your sins, not some of it, all of your sins, and cleanse you from all unrighteousness. That's why He's calling you. He is the only man, the only person, sorry, that can fix your sin problem. You cannot fix it yourself. You can't fix it with money. You can't fix it with good deeds. You can't fix it with tears. He alone is able to wash your sins away, because sin, hallelujah, affects every part of you. And God is able to fix that through the blood of His Son, Jesus, who died on Calvary for you and for me. He's able to fix that. So that's why He's calling you. No one else can fix your problem. No other person can fix it. Jesus says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man come to the Father but by me. He's the only person that can fix your problem. That's why He's calling you to come to Him. Come to Him today. Hallelujah. He's calling you finally to reason. He's calling you because time is short. He's calling you because He's the only man, the only person, the only God that can fix your sin problem. And finally, He's calling you because judgment is set. He's calling you because judgment is set. The Bible tells us, hallelujah, when we read further down, He says, hallelujah, if you refuse and rebel, the sword of the Lord would be against you. The sword of the Lord will devour you. History has taught us that Noah would have preached to the people saying, come into the ark. They refused and they all were destroyed. Sodom and Gomorrah, they did not turn from their sins. They refused and they were destroyed. Today, God is warning us that the appointed time, His judgment is set. He says, hallelujah, that He's appointed a day of wrath where He will judge the world. And every man will have to stand before Him and give an account of themselves to God. Revelation chapter 20 from verse 11 to 15 give us the account of those who did not obey the call and refuse. They will have to stand before Him. And when He's through, He said, well, depart from me, because they refuse. They rebelled against the call of God. And I'm praying today that you hear the word of God. You will not refuse and you will not rebel against a call. Some people refuse because the agenda for their life has been set and nobody changing that. They are hoping that God don't come in their lifetime because they have a number of things that they want to accomplish. But much more than that, they want to accomplish things. They are not putting the value they ought to put on their soul as they should. The most important thing in your life is not things. Don't set your affection on things. Hallelujah. But set your affections on things above. Come on. God love you. And he has sent his only begotten son to die in your place. And if you refuse him, if you refuse Jesus as your Lord and Savior, if you put it off, if you rebel against it, you will be destroyed. The children of Israel were destroyed many times in history. Hallelujah, because they refused the laws of God and to obey it. Hallelujah, they were captive by the Egyptians. They were then captive by the Assyrians. The Babylonians came and take them over and captivate them for a long, long time. After the Babylonians, hallelujah, came the Medes and the Persians, hallelujah, and captivate them. And after the Medes and Persians came the Roman Empire, who ruled and conquered them for a long, long time. History, let history teach us today that God is serious about his word. He says, if you be willing and obedient to his call, if you be willing and obedient. Some people are willing, but they are not obedient. You have to be both. You have to be willing and obedient. And then you will experience the goodness of God. Then you will experience the grace of God. Then you will experience his pardon, his forgiveness, his mercy, his blessings. And more than that, his promises. I want to challenge you today to take the route of obeying the master's call. I want to encourage you, if you hear this word today, that you would not choose the route to refuse and to rebel. Because if you do, the sword of the Lord speaks of his judgment to come. The sword of the Lord speaks about that day of reckoning. But I hope to God, when you hear the voice of God, you will appeal and open your heart and say, Lord, I'm sorry for my sins. Please forgive me. Wash me in your precious blood. If you're willing to do that right now, I want you to join me in this prayer. Saying, Oh God, I'm sorry for my sin. I am willing and I'm obedient to your call today. Forgive me of my sins. Wash me in your precious blood. Cleanse me from all unrighteousness. I accept your son Jesus into my heart as my Lord and personal Savior. And I'm prepared to follow him all the way. So help me, O God, in Jesus' name. Amen. If you have prayed that prayer, you are saved. I want to encourage you to find a good Bible-believing church in your area. Find a Bible, read it. Tell your pastor, whoever in charge of that church, of the decision you have made, and they will help you and disciple you until you are strong and live according to the commitment of Almighty God. I want to thank you for viewing today. May the Lord richly bless you. May the Lord cause his face to shine upon you. May the Lord be gracious to you and bless you and your family in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you again for viewing the expression of the Father's love. The Lord bless you. Have a wonderful day. In Jesus' name, amen.